Good morning. Good to see you all. I wanted us to spend just a little bit of time in these days right before Christmas, just thinking through and hopefully being able to celebrate Mary and have some conversation about her and about her role in our tradition, about her role in the wider church. And I want us to begin again today by just by singing together. And David Sinden, who's back in the far end of the room, is going to lead us. David, we're ready.
The angel Gabriel from heaven came. His wings as drifted snow, his eyes as flame. All hail, said he, the lowly maiden Mary, most highly favored lady, Gloria. Of her Emmanuel the Christ was born. In Bethlehem all on a Christmas morn. And Christian folk throughout the world will ever say, most highly favored Lady Gloria.
So as I said, I wanted us to have some conversation around Mary and, again, her role in our tradition, her role in the wider church. But I thought before I go any farther, I'd like to hear from you. When you think about or have thought about, or if you've ever thought much about, Mary, who's referred to in a more formal way as the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, what comes to mind for you?
My mother, who was devoted to Mary and saw her as the way to Jesus. As his mother, she could ask him anything. Mm-hmm. So if you were hurting or you were sad, she would turn to Mary. Mm-hmm. And so I think Mary, I still have a beautiful statue of Mary right by my bed. It just reminds me of motherhood and what mothers will do.
So for her, Mary was an intercessor then.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Great. Great. Other thoughts about Mary, Susie?
When I was 10, I was in Kansas, and for some reason, I was sitting outside a convent. I don't know what. And I was gazing through a gate, and there was a statue of this gorgeous, wonderful woman with flowing robes and with her hands held out. And I promised myself that I would be as good as Mary was forever and ever and ever. I thought I'd be the next Mary, I guess.
How's that work for you?
but it was her, it was her hands held out. Mm-hmm. The welcoming. Mm-hmm. I will take you in.
Yeah. Okay.
So I'm a child of the 60s. I was probably 6 years old at Episcopal Church. I never understood, and I still don't today, why it took 2,000 years to have women bishops and in other churches, why there aren't women deacons.
Uh-huh.
We wouldn't be here without the cultural influence of motherhood and all that.
Okay, great.
Well, I was raised as a Catholic and went to Catholic school.
Uh-huh.
And Mary was a big deal. We had Mary statues all over school. And for the holy day in May, we would all, when we were really little, like first grade, we got dressed in these long gowns that the school had, and we'd march around the whole school grounds, and we'd end up at this beautiful statue of Mary that was outside, mm-hmm. And so, to me, I guess I have kind of a different relationship, because back then, we were basically worshiping Mary.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
I don't feel that's the right thing to do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so it's kind of complicated. But I just remember when I think of Mary, I think about the childhood stuff.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Okay. Great. Thank you. Other comments, thoughts about Mary?
I think her heart, excuse me, a loving, kind symbol or person who says everything's going to be okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Great. Thank you.
To risk going more into complicated, I think about our images of women and what's appropriate. And I'm struck that you said the ever blessed Virgin Mary in contrast to the ever virgin blessed Mary.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
It seems like she has a large position in my mind when she gets the news and then she shares with her friend who's also pregnant. And then she trudges all the way to Bethlehem and then flees. And then for me, she kind of disappears.
Mm.
And she kind of loses, you know, goes to maybe in the home, but we don't know much of anything about that.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So sort of always amazed that she has such a big presence.
Mm-hmm.
Evaporates.
Yeah. Okay. Great. We're gonna talk about both of those pieces of Mary. Other reactions, thoughts.
I just read a wonderful Advent commentary on Mary where she is pointing to Jesus and said, this is my son.
A little bit louder, Sabina.
Mary was pointing to Jesus saying, this is my son who is God, but he grew inside of me.
Mm-hmm.
How can you invite him to grow something good inside of you?
Mm-hmm.
I thought that was really cool. So uh-huh. I always see kind of Mary pointing
uh-huh.
to her son.
Uh-huh.
You know.
Yeah. Okay. So, we may be just a little bit slow this morning on our slides, but so as you all have already alluded to, and what we know historically is that Mary, as the mother of Jesus or the mother of Christ, has been revered, celebrated, acknowledged, recognized, prayed to since the earliest days. Of the Christian church. And what we also know, Dudley was just talking about, her kind of disappearing. What we also know is that she was actually there in Jerusalem with the 12 apostles after the resurrection. And so from that point on, as the church began to grow and to develop and then eventually to flourish, then Mary has been, again, celebrated, revered, in some cases worshipped, in some cases looked to as an intercessor, even though there's limited scriptural basis for some of what has transpired about Mary. But a lot of this grew out of some of the conversations, the debates, the arguments, the heresies, that began to really take place in the 3rd and 4th centuries and then were part of what went into the councils of the church, as they were called, that were pulled together to talk about who was Jesus. Was Jesus divine and human? Was Jesus... All of those questions then, in some ways, also involve Mary. So as you know, as you well know, there are all kinds of images of Mary. Right, she's been portrayed by famous artists and in a variety of ways. This one by Da Vinci is just a pretty basic one. This one is one where as you can see, there's a crown that's being placed on Mary's head. This is from a well-known altarpiece. Here again is one where a crown is being placed on her head, and this is a depiction of her, of what the Roman Catholic Church holds up as being her assumption into heaven. In other words, she ascended into heaven in the same way that Jesus that we talk about Jesus ascended and being that Jesus went up into heaven. That Mary was bodily, there was a bodily assumption of Mary into heaven. And then, you know, of course, obviously other cultures and have depicted her in various ways also. So I want to start with our tradition. This comes from the 39 articles, which are in the back of the Book of Common Prayer, which form some of the basis for who we are as Episcopalians. And this is article number 22. The Romish doctrine concerning purgatory, pardons, worshiping, and adoration, as well of images as of relics, and also invocation of saints, is a fond thing vainly invented and grounded upon no warranty of Scripture. Pretty clear there, isn't it? So really, the point here was really this. Was this invocation of saints that in other words there couldn't, you know, the part of the Protestant movement that took place in, you know, in England and Germany and France and all these places was to put as much distance as we could between this reforming or this reshaping of the church and what the church had been for centuries, as in the Roman Catholic Church. And so one of those things was this, that there does not have to be a mediator between you and me and God. That makes sense. So what?
Roman Catholic.
Yeah, exactly. So what Katie was describing, you know, what Sandy was talking about was that one of those Romish doctrines that again has kind of helped to lay the foundation for how, you know, we, even though we're not truly Protestant. You know, we're that middle way. You know, you have the Roman Catholic Church over here. You have the real Protestant Church over here, Southern Baptist, Methodist, Presbyterians, and then there's us. You know, the Anglican tradition of which we're a part of as Episcopalians, which, you know, kind of has one foot over here and these and this part of Mary, maybe a little bit of a foot over here in this part of Mary, and so we try to figure out how we do some of this. And so, this was part of, again, the groundwork for how we have typically, and I think in some cases what you can argue is that we threw the baby out with the bathwater. You know, we threw a lot of things out just in defiance of or saying that anything that was Romish in nature was wrong. Okay. And that happened with a lot of different ways. So, again, while we have come to hold Mary in the highest of esteem, we remember Mary in our prayers. We have various ways in which we acknowledge and recognize Mary in the liturgical calendar of our church. The things that we continue to disagree with, or to have some disagreements with the Roman Catholic tradition and the Eastern Orthodox tradition, would be around some of these types of things: the Immaculate Conception, Mary's perpetual virginity, and as I've already referred to, her assumption into heaven. And this has been based upon on the fact that there's nothing in the Bible that points to any of those. Okay? Now, that's not to say there's not other things in the Bible that haven't become traditions in the church, but these things related to Mary that had become dogma in the Roman Catholic Church and part of the doctrine are things that we say have no warrant in Holy Scripture, and so we then have chosen not to recognize Mary in that way. Okay?
The Immaculate Conception?
I'm sorry. I got ahead of myself. Well, that Mary was immaculately conceived.
Oh, I see.
That Mary was immaculately conceived, because what the doctrine there is that if she was not immaculately conceived, then she would have been with sin. Okay? So in the same way that Jesus was immaculately conceived, then Mary was immaculately conceived so that she could be sinless. Yes. So now we do believe in the Immaculate Conception, I hope, or I'm not going to show up on this coming Saturday. I'll get the day off. So one of the ways in which Mary has been held up, and in which we talk about, which we talk about Mary, is something that came out of one of those councils of the church that I mentioned a little while ago, and it was in response to one of the heresies of the church, where again there was conversation and discussion about, well, okay, who was Jesus? Was Jesus part man and part divine? Part divine, part man. What, you know, all these. And there was one particular heresy that talked about how that Jesus was divine and human, and that those were two separate natures, that those were not combined, that the humanity and divinity of Jesus were not combined. Those were two separate things. And so in response to that, there was a council of the church that was called in 451 A.D., who then identified Mary as being the bearer of God, or the God-bearer, Theotokos. And that was in response to what this heresy was pointing, what became identified as a heresy was claiming, is that Mary was the Christotokos, was the bearer of Christ, not the bearer of God. So that is one of the ways in which Mary began to be looked at and recognized and held up as being the one who brought God into being through the birth of Jesus. So that there was, if you see here, acknowledge one and the same Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at once complete in the Godhead and complete in manhood. So no separation between human and God. All one, truly God and truly man, of one substance with the Father. So all of that comes together, and that Mary then brought that into being. That Mary was the bearer of God. I think it's a pretty powerful way to look at Mary, as being the God-bearer. Now the Orthodox, I want to, Jacqueline's going to play a prayer, a chant, that I don't know whether it made it into my... No. And this is what you're going to hear is a chant that is still used in the Greek and Eastern Orthodox churches today, that came from a piece of papyrus that was found that mentioned Mary as being the bearer of God, the Theotokos. And this goes back to the ancient church in Egypt, the Coptic church. And again, this is something that's still, we're not going to play all of it, but just wanted you to hear how still today Mary is held up in this way as being the Theotokos. So that gives you some idea, and again, that's used at almost every service, what's called Vespers in the Orthodox Church, where at the end they chant this this song or this prayer of Mary. So it's important, I think, for us to remember Mary for her role as the God-bearer, the Mother of God, for her typological fulfillment of figures in the Old Testament. And one way to look at that is to say that as we know, Mary was willing to say yes. Remember, the angel Gabriel comes, we're going to talk about that in a moment, comes to Mary and says, this is what's going to happen. And Mary says, okay, let it be with me, according to your word. So she's compared to the fulfillment of what happened, if we go back to Genesis, where Eve said no. Eve in the garden said no, that she was not going to do what God was asking her to do. Mary fulfilled that. And then again, the fact that she was willing to do what she did, and the way we often hold Mary up as being an example of what it means to live a life of faith, to be willing to step out into the unknown, which is the story that we have from the Bible of her being willing to say yes and then to do what God was asking her to do, even though she was probably 12 or 13 years old and had no idea. So that's what we just heard a moment ago. Sorry, we got a little bit out of order. So this comes from that heresy that I was talking about when St. Gregory of Nazianzus said, if someone does not uphold that the Holy Mary is Theotokos, the Mother of God, then he or she has separated themselves from God. So that was the sentiment. That's how strong the sentiment was at that time in trying to push back on this what was determined deemed to be a heretical movement. So I think Dudley mentioned a while ago, kind of wondering, okay, so where did Mary go? You know, we're going to read all about her on Saturday. We hear about her this morning in our gospel reading about her role in the birth of Christ. But where did she go? So this is what we know about what happened to Mary, and this is where she's mentioned in some way. Obviously, her relationship to Joseph, and that's what we hear about today, was how she and Joseph became connected to each other. The annunciation by the angel Gabriel that she would bear a son, and this is what the son would be named. Right? So we have Mary mentioned there in Luke's gospel. And then Mary's visit to her cousin Elizabeth, who was also pregnant with John the Baptist, obviously in the birth of Jesus. Then we hear about her being part of presenting Jesus to the temple in that period of time after the birth of Jesus. The visit to Jerusalem when Jesus was 12 years old. The wedding, the first miracle in John's gospel that's recorded that Jesus performed, his mother Mary was there. There's an occasion when Mary and Jesus' brothers asked to speak to Jesus while he was preaching and teaching to people, and Mary's reference there. And then we know that the crucifixion was when Jesus commended her to John. We know that she was one of the group of women who was at the crucifixion when all the guys bailed out. Then the women were the ones who were there. And then finally, as I mentioned a few moments ago, that Mary was part of that group who did what Jesus told them to do after his resurrection and ascension. And he said, go to Jerusalem and wait, and something is going to happen. And we know that she was part of that group who went and stayed together and prayed together and worshiped together and ate together until the day that we now refer to as being the day of Pentecost, when it became evident to them what they were supposed to do. So Dudley, there's some things that it might not be always be obvious. We don't always, I think maybe part of the reason why we lose sight of some of this is because, like you said, we kind of go, oh, well, Mary, who gave birth to Jesus, and we celebrate it and we sentimentalize it at this time of the year, and then we just kind of forget about her. You know, in some ways, in terms of remembering how she is actually referenced and where she, in these other places where she actually does come into play throughout the life of Jesus and as depicted in parts of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the four Gospels. So what we know is that, and what we hold up is that Mary was not some. Mary was a, was what we're told and what we know of someone like her. That in the way she's depicted is that she was not special. She was not privileged. She was not anything but a young, uneducated girl that God chose to approach, to come to, and say, "This is what is going to happen to you. This is who you are going to be." And that's the way that God chose to come into the world. That's the way God chose to act. Now, we all know that God could have chosen to act in a whole bunch of different ways, right? God didn't have to act through somebody like Mary. God didn't have to do what God did in coming into the world in the way that God did. But that's the way that God chose to act. And part of what makes Mary special is that we can look at her hopefully in the same way that we look at Jesus as being, you know, fully human but fully divine, and look at Mary and say, okay, well, this is the way that God chose to do this through this fragile human being. This is how God chose to make God's self known to the world. Does that make some sense? So this is what we hear in Luke's gospel. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel, was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph. Now, again, if you've been to church or coming to church, you're going to hear an account of this in Matthew's gospel. This is obviously from Luke. The virgin's name was Mary, and the angel came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." She was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. And maybe you've heard sermons, heard talks, read things about, you know, what that must have been like to get hit with this news. The Lord is with you. Greetings, favored one. The angel said to her, "Don't be afraid, for you have found favor with God, and now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus." Okay? Now, you notice there's nothing in here that says that Mary was interviewed, right? There's nothing that says that this came directly from Mary. This, again, was part of that oral tradition of what was passed down through the generations from the point where this happened or however it happened. This became part of the tradition of the church. This became part of what we're told is the way in which God chose again to come into the world through a virgin named Mary. And then what we now hold up is the fact that Mary said yes. That Mary's willingness to say yes is something that had to happen in order for the birth of Jesus to take place in the way that it did. Again, God could have chosen to do this in a different way. We all know that, but that's not how what God chose to do. This is how what God chose to do. And so what we now proclaim as being Mary's song or the Magnificat is Mary's response, which also comes from Luke, in which she says, "My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God my Savior." Let's read this together. "For he has looked with favor on his lowly servant. From this day, all generations will call me blessed. The Almighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. He has mercy on those who fear him in every generation. He has shown the strength of his arm. He has scattered the proud in their conceit. He has cast down the mighty from their thrones and has lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has come to the help of his servant Israel, for he has remembered his promise of mercy, the promise he made to our fathers, to Abraham and his children forever." So again, this was Mary's response to "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you. You're going to bear a child, even though you're a virgin, you're uneducated, you're not married, all these things. This is what's going to happen to you." And then Mary's response was based on, you know, what she would have known and what would have come out of her own Jewishness and what she would have been exposed to as part of her own tradition. So what we take away or we pull out of this Magnificat or this song of Mary is that she seemed to be filled with just this sense of awe and gladness, which again kind of runs against the grain of the way the story is set up. What we would have thought would have been that she would have, you know, just bailed out, you know, or would have just, you know, hightailed it off and said, "No, not me." But what we come away with, or at least the way the story is told, the way those who are writing the Gospels, at least of Luke and in Luke's Gospel, this is not in Matthew's Gospel, but in Luke's Gospel, and what we hear of Mary and Matthew's Gospel, then which again are the only two places where there's an account of the birth. Is that she was filled with joy, with gladness, with a sense of awe, and also knowing that whatever was going to happen to her, she was placing herself into the hands of God. I mean, this is a woman who knew she needed something, right? This was a young girl who knew that she had, that this couldn't happen just because of anything that she was going to do. And so she recognized her need for and her dependence upon God, which again is part of Mary's story and part of how I think that we can relate to it. how we, as those who are dependent upon God, how those of us who are weak and sometimes helpless and who get sick and who have stuff happen and who have to face our own mortality, know that in the same way that Mary called out to God, that we sometimes call out to God, knowing that we need God. We're dependent upon God. So as we pointed out, when Jesus was crucified, Mary was one of the groups, was one who was there with him at the cross after his resurrection, went with him to Jerusalem. So let's talk a little bit about how we recognize Mary. So every year on August the 15th in the liturgical calendar of the Episcopal Church, we celebrate the Feast of St. Mary the Virgin. Now, as you may know, there are churches in our tradition that are named after Mary. There are a whole bunch of St. Marys in lots of different places. And often those churches tend to be what's referred to as high church, Anglo-Catholic in their orientation in terms of their worship and sometimes in their theology. But often these churches make a really big deal of the feast of Mary. On the liturgical calendar, there are the most significant feast days are marked with is either being red or white, and this is one that is one of those significant feast days. And this is also, even though again we don't believe that she was assumed into heaven, this is also the traditional date of her assumption. When it was believed by the Roman Catholic Church and the Orthodox Church that her body was taken up to heaven, and then here are some other days in which we recognize or think about Mary in our liturgical calendar. March the 25th is the Annunciation of our Lord Jesus Christ to the Blessed Virgin Mary. That what we just talked about when Gabriel came and said, "This is what's going to happen to you." And that date, March, anybody know why it's set in March?
9 months.
Until December, yeah, until December 25th. Obviously, on December the 25th is the Nativity of our Lord Jesus Christ. February the 2nd is the Presentation of our Lord Jesus Christ in the temple. And then on May the 31st is the Visitation of the Blessed Virgin. So those are some of the ways in which we, even though we might, again, feel like we've kind of thrown sometimes the baby out with the bathwater with Mary, these are the days we actually remember Mary more than we give ourselves sometimes credit for. And she is a more important figure than sometimes I think that we want to remember to hold up. I wanted to So this is a part of a song that was written by Amy Grant that I think has something to say about Mary. I have traveled many moonless nights, cold and weary, with a babe inside, and I wonder what I've done. Holy Father, you have come and chosen me now to carry your son. I am waiting in silent prayer. I am frightened by the load I bear. In a world as cold as stone, must I walk this path alone? Help me be strong. Be with me now. Do you wonder when you watch my face if a wiser one should have had my place? Help me be strong. Help me. And again, "Breath of Heaven" is the name of the song written by Amy Grant as her tribute to Mary. All right, so we began with some of your thoughts and impressions. So now that we've kind of done a run through of some of how we look at Mary and how Mary has been looked at historically, other thoughts, comments, questions.
So for me, the whole idea of Mary as intercessor, which I say was much more my mother's thing, but the idea of Mary's motherhood and giving into that, I think, had a big place in my life. But she at Cana, and I may have this wrong, this may just be a figment of my imagination, but I thought it was she who went to Jesus and said, these people are embarrassed and they need more wine.
Correct.
Can't you help?
Mm-hmm.
This was not an earth-changing miracle, but it was his first miracle,
mm-hmm.
and it was at her behest. Is that correct?
Well,
kind of, sort of?
Yeah. Well, yeah. But also you remember that Jesus was somewhat dismissive of her also.
Right.
Remember that? Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But then
he went ahead and did it. But basically, he was saying, "What business is this of yours?"
Mm-hmm. Well, it's just wine.
Right. Yeah. Why should you be concerned, you know, about this? And that's not the only time you see that kind of interesting interaction between Jesus and, you know, there was the time also that I referenced where his mother and siblings want to talk to him, and he's also dismissive, you know. So, but yes, I mean, that what I think the significance there is the fact that it's another touch point for where we see that Mary was there, where she is referenced, you know, at a time that was significant enough for John in John's gospel to portray that as being kind of Jesus' entree into the rest of his ministry.
Yeah.
Have you ever looked into Mary in the book of Revelation, or at least the Catholic Church said it's Mary's in the book of Revelation, which I never knew. So I looked it up the other day, and it says there appeared a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and upon her head crown of 12 stars, and she being with child cried travailing in birth, and she brought forth a man child who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron, and the child was caught up unto God into his throne.
Mm-hmm.
I thought that was just, if that's not Mary, I don't know.
Yeah.
those are the characters. That's the hagiography.
That's exactly
see
right.
All
yeah,
the, right, of the crown.
And
yeah.
I'm like, that's where it comes from. I never knew that.
Yeah.
You never hear much about the relationship between Joseph and Mary, except in the very beginning, and then Joseph sort of fades out of the picture.
Yeah. Now, and he really, unlike Mary, Joseph really does fade out of the picture. And if you've heard Susie preach already this morning, you've heard a little bit about that. And if you haven't, you're going to hear a little bit about that. But yeah, what we know about Joseph just isn't a whole lot. Yeah. But you're right. There's not after the birth story and the presentation, then we really just don't hear much more about Joseph. But again, you know, I think it's always important to remember what was important to those who were writing the stories. You know, Mary, as I've already mentioned, was a central figure, you know, to them at that point, 40 to 50 years later, when these stories were being written. Joseph probably wasn't. You know, Joseph's role was somewhat more limited, and even though Joseph, you know, be certainly held up for the role that he played, his ongoing role, I don't know. Maybe he wasn't around in the same way that Mary was. Maybe he wasn't. Maybe he died. Who knows? You know, life expectancy at that point wasn't very long, and you know, so who knows what happened?
I have a question. What do they call the stories that didn't make it into the Bible, and how was it decided, you know, a long time ago, what made it to the New Testament?
Yeah, well.
Or is that
I don't know. Susie, you want to tackle that one?
It's a long story.
Yeah. Well, it is a long story. It's a great question.
Well,
Again,
is there a name for all that text?
All that text that
didn't make it into the Bible.
Well, some of it is found in the Apocrypha, what's called the Apocrypha, that's in our tradition, but not all traditions even, not all denominations and churches even use those writings. There's also the Gospel of
Thomas.
Thank you. I was about to say Timothy. The Gospel of Thomas
that has some
theological strengths, but just was not included.
Well, is that in the Roman Catholic Bible?
No.
Oh.
Mm-mm. No.
Is the term she's looking for non-canonical? Is that what you're looking?
Okay. The Gospel of Thomas has this wonderful story about how when Jesus is a young boy, he molds a bird out of mud, and then he blows on the bird, and it flies away.
That's pretty cool.
Some of those supernatural things that just didn't make it in terms of who Jesus really was.
Yeah.
There's one of him, maybe it was one of the disciples, they flew in the air. They became airborne. That was one of the thrown out magic.
Other comments, questions about Mary? Well, I hope as we move into this week and as we celebrate the birth that we can remember her role and her importance, and as we celebrate Christmas, that we'll be able to celebrate and give thanks to God for Mary and her continued role in our tradition and in the larger church. Thank you all for being part of this. Good to be with you. God bless. Thank you.